Hello, everyone. Tonight I'm going to read an article from Forbes.com, 5 Ways to Shut Down a Narcissist. Now, this article is from Stephen Burglis, contributor, and he goes to explain narcissism and breaks it down in a very simplistic way, but I thought it would give everyone a little spin since he was dealing with narcissists on Wall Street, and what a better place for narcissists and psychopaths, right? And he does a really good job of it, and I thought maybe some people could identify. Playing people is what narcissists do whenever they are not sleeping. They also play entities if they believe doing so will help them accrue money and/or power. If you look at the Facebook IPO with these observations in mind, you can appreciate how what became a feeding frenzy went bust. Facebook, the entity, was adored by narcissists. What's a greater high for narcissists than discussing themselves and having others like what they say? Facebook, the IPO, was adored. Nearly 1 billion people are in on it. It's great. But when Facebook, the stock, failed to take off like Google's did, narcissists exhibited their most loathsome propensity. They debased and disparaged a social networking system they once put on a pedestal, claiming it was nothing more than a glorified version of two Dixie cups connected by a string. Those of you clinging to the notion that Morgan Stanley miscalculations were to blame for the Facebook IPO fiasco can forget about it. Wall Street is a venue for showcasing mankind's worst psychological flaws, narcissism being chief among them. The traditional view on the street has been bulls and bears get fed, pigs get slaughtered. But this no longer captures the mood of the times. Today, prototypic Wall Street client lives by the credo, idealization leads to devaluation. And seasoned professionals on the street know that getting anywhere near the downward swing of this pendulum can cut you like a razor. Here's what the process of idealization leads to devaluation is all about. Children see objects, entities, that's what he calls them, in their world as all good or all bad. Like the stories they love, only heroes and villains inhabit the land in which they live. Their tender young egos cannot make sense of complex characters with very varying personalities. Integrating good and bad traits within one person overwhelms them, but what do you expect? Adults have trouble with characters like Walt Kowalski, the retired auto worker played by Clint Eastwood in Gran Torino. On one hand, he's a loathsome racist. On the other hand, a sensitive father figure to a young Hmong immigrant who lives next door to him. If you found it hard to make sense of Eastwood as Kowalski, how can kids make sense of complex personalities that refuse to identify who they are by wearing either a white or black hat? They cannot, but fortunately, a child's ego comes equipped with factory-installed defense mechanisms that enable him to cope with complex personalities. The process is called splitting, bifurcating the world into idealized or devalued objects that gain the child's affection or incur the child's loathing. If dad is good to a child, he is loved. If dad yells and scares a child, he is hated. Kids don't allow for dad having a bad day or getting caught by broken glass. Normally, the need to employ the splitting defense wanes as a child ages. For some, however, it does not, and the child remains a splitter into adulthood. People in his world are put on pedestals one moment and knocked off the next, making intimate emotional relationships a pipe dream. Even non-intimate relationships with narcissists are nightmarish. What constitutes great work on Monday can become unprofessional and inappropriate behavior by Thursday for reasons discernible only to seers, soothsayers, or shrinks. If you haven't seen splitting in action, you will. Narcissists regularly rise to the top of the workplace hierarchies, owing to a unique ability to secure approval and admiration, two forms of recognition they need to survive in the way the rest of us need oxygen and water. Worse yet, narcissists are able to ascend to the upper echelons of organizations without revealing their true colors until they amass enough power to make it unnecessary to sustain their facade. Once a narcissist can say, "Screw you," with impunity, he will use splitting to cut the legs out from under everyone he previously set up to believe they were cared for. To avoid being played in this manner, study the following five characteristics of narcissists and the strategies for managing them. Failing to grasp what you are dealing with guarantees that a narcissist will make your life a living hell. Narcissists promise gold, but deliver pyrite. If you want a primer on narcissism, watch Oliver Stone's movie Wall Street. It illustrates how corporate raider and supreme narcissist Gordon Gekko used every nuance of splitting in the book to grind those close to him into the dirt. Take, for example, how Gekko told Bud Fox, a broker who emulated his every move, "I'm going to make you rich, Bud Fox." In the end, Fox made a fortune working for Gekko, but he was indicted by the SEC for insider trading, the gift that made Gekko appreciate him, and ultimately jailed. What can you do about narcissist overpromising? Keep your expectations of what they will deliver as low as possible and understand they will give you only what they need to sustain your involvement with them. When you no longer serve a function in their life, they will dump you. Until that day comes, play their game. Never expect anything from them you do not pay for, in advance and in excess of fair market value. Narcissists never like you, care about you, or become your friend. Gordon Gekko also told Bud Fox, "If you need a friend, get a dog." The savagery of this remark lies in its killing two sacred cows with one blow. A. Gekko was ostensibly Fox's friend, so the remark gave lie to something Fox valued, and B. Gekko denigrated the concept of friendship, rendering it to no more valuable than a canine's bonding reflex. When a narcissist appears to be befriending you, he is really engaged in a complex process of creating quid pro quo deals, the type of exchanges Don Vito Corleone was famous for. If you know this, wear a Kevlar vest to protect your heart and play your own version of Let's Make a Deal. If a narcissist invites you to his beach house, have him visit your ski lodge. Then, regardless of which retreat you're at, never delude yourself into believing the narcissist enjoys your company. He wants you to feel special, so if he needs you, you'll respond like Pavlov's dog. Never criticize a narcissist. Present constructive feedback as mild praise. Years ago, I worked for a narcissist who regularly lauded my work. Then everything changed. A week after sending me a box of Cuban cigars accompanied by a note that read, "Thank you, genius," the client fired me. Why? After he didn't respond to a dozen emails reminding him I had not been compensated for my work, I called to remind him. When you criticize a narcissist, regardless of how accurate you are, you run the risk of inflicting a narcissistic injury and becoming the target of narcissistic rage. For having the temerity to remind my client, any accusation will cause him to feel shame, and nothing wounds a narcissist more than humiliation. Instead, tell him you need his help to understand your world. His view won't jibe with yours, but if you repeat the request often enough, using measured words in a calm manner, you may elicit an awareness of obligation in a person whose mother told him he was her son, S-U-N, and never realized that what she should have called him was son, S-O-N. Never ignore a narcissist. On the street, narcissists are called egomaniacs, not because their egos are blown out of proportion from achievements, but owing to their own maniacal obsession with themselves. They're standing vis-a-vis those who've made it and their compensatory need to inflate what is actually a damaged sense of self. A friend of mine once asked, "Tell me what parents do to create narcissists." I told him it was complicated, but he insisted I provide him with one action that explains how egomaniacs become who they are. Finally, I said, they do it by making little Johnny a showpiece, telling all who'll pay attention, "Look at how special my son is." As an adult, Jonathan loathes the memory of being made into an object used to gratify his parents' needs for attention, yet depends on the same sort of attention to survive. To work for or with a narcissist, you must be responsive the moment they demand attention. If you cannot respond to the bell, don't sign up for the job. If you do react as desired, what can save you from psychic torment is learning to temper the narcissist's demands without incurring his wrath. Responses such as "sounds good to me" chill the needy child by affirming his worldview while limiting your involvement in actualizing it. Have compassion for the narcissist. It is hard to dredge up sympathy for a narcissist, since working with or for one sets you up for an inevitable beatdown. You can forestall this outcome if you distance yourself emotionally as described above, and remind yourself that beneath his flimsy veneer of power, he is the terrified Wizard of Oz, shaking behind a curtain that shields him from being seen for who he is. You can also try to imagine how you would feel suffering a chronic need to hear that the world holds you in high regard, knowing you will crumble like a house of cards if your self-deceptions aren't validated. Cocaine addicts have an easier time navigating through a day than narcissists do, since all they need is a chemical fix. Nothing about their addiction forces them to hide a character flaw from those they depend on to love them. Do not mistake my compassion for narcissists as directing you to befriend them. If you try to and succeed, your victory will be short-lived. Intimacy arouses vulnerability in narcissists by triggering a recollection of how their parents exploited them. Instead, think of narcissists as suffering chronic pain, harboring the deluded belief that living the good life or making windfall profits from an IPO will cure them. You know these fixes never work, but forgive them for their folly to the extent that you can. Well, that's the end of the article, and I hope that helps someone tonight. Peace out.